Petty, Allison, Waltrip, Winston Cup Racing, a sport where great drivers become great legends. Now you have the opportunity to take a look behind the scenes at some of racing's best through the Great Legends of Racing home video series. Each volume will introduce you to one of NASCAR's celebrated families. Join Benny Parsons as he takes you down on the farm with Darrell and Michael Waltrip to Level Cross to meet the legendary king of racing, Richard Petty, and his son, Kyle. Benny travels down to the heart of Dixie and the home of the Alabama Gang with Bobby and Davey Allison. The Lone Star racing legacy of the Labontes unfolds with the 1984 champion Terry and Winston Cup newcomer Bobby. Don't miss any of the action. Collect the whole series. For more information on how to get your copy, call 704-541-6600 or write Great Legends in Racing, 7621 Little Avenue, Suite 516, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28226. Now you can own the definitive documentary on the King, a production as hard-driving as the man himself, Richard Petty, the legend. This limited edition two-volume home video includes the official Petty collector's card. And if you order now, you'll receive this free commemorative poster. To order, call area code 704-541-6600 or send $38.95 plus $5 shipping and handling to Richard Petty, the legend, 7621 Little Avenue, Suite 516, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28226.
Wallaces, a family rooted in racing, with a reputation founded in victory. Living in the heartland of America, Rusty, Mike, and Kenny Wallace grew up much like other boys. But instead of playing ball or going fishing in their free time, they went to the races. And there a love for cars, speed, and competition was born. Rusty was the first to pursue the dream of racing for a living, eventually reaching his goal of Winston Cup champion. Kenny followed in his big brother's footsteps and now, after a successful Busch career, has joined the Winston Cup rank. Middle brother Mike is currently driving on the Busch circuit. But the Wallace racing success dates back to a time before Rusty, Kenny, and Mike.
My father started to race.
He was a racer?
Yeah, he was a doggone good racer, too. He won the championship in St. Louis, Missouri, and over at Granite City, Illinois, which is a dirt track over there. And he ran just all the little dirt tracks and the asphalt tracks around the area, and he's the one who kind of put it in our blood, I got to tell you that one.
So did you work helping him go to the races?
Yeah, Kenny, myself, my brother Mike, we all worked. We were Dad's pit crew. And he won so many races, he was really popular. Then we got involved in it. We started building our own engines there at the shop behind the house and building our own cars. And it just evolved from there.
Rusty Wallace started racing at age 16 and won the first race he entered, a heat race. In his excitement over the victory, he forgot to refill the gas tank and ran out of gas during the feature event. Racing out of his St. Louis shop, a young Rusty started Poor Boy Chassis Company to finance his racing habit. Along with his best friend, Charlie Chase, they would build race cars and sell them to other drivers. Now, they'd use that money to go racing themselves. Then, when they were out of money, they would build another car and start the cycle again. Youngest brother Kenny, he helped out in the garage while Rusty's other brother, current Busch driver Mike, chose the family business.
I thought the family business was one entity I wanted to do. I thought, well, I have the best of both worlds. I'll race on the weekends and work a normal job, make good money, but that's not what it's like, and that's not what I want to do, along with I found out you can make as much or more money down here doing this. So just was late coming into it, late, you know, far as being the middle of the brother. Normally everybody says, oh, you're the younger brother. I'm just the last one getting here. The thing about it, I was very successful in the Midwest racing short track dirt cars and asphalt cars there. And matter of fact, I've raced longer than Kenny has, you know, and but it just, circumstances change. It was a situation, like I said, I was running the family business, was doing well at that, and just got to a point where that family business every day was not what I wanted to do the rest of my life.
What was the family business?
Vacuum cleaners. A company called OK Vacuum in St. Louis, and it's real big right now, still exists. And we sell ride-on floor scrubbers and machines and all the equipment and the cleaners to service everything throughout the metropolitan St. Louis area. But Mike got real involved in doing that.
Did you ever work in the family business?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I got fired.
Yeah. We both got fired.
Did you?
Yes. They did us a favor.
Yeah. I got right in there, and that's just the reason I got fired is because I was working on the vacuum cleaners, and my mind was on stock cars. And
tell them the barrel story.
My uncle hired one guy there, and I couldn't get along with that guy to save my rear end. I just couldn't get along with him, didn't like him, didn't gel. And this guy went out and bought a new Ford pickup truck. And during lunchtime, me and my buddies that worked there went out there, opened his hood, crossed all the spark plug wires in the thing for him. And it got time to go. 5 o'clock, man, I was out it. All of a sudden I hear, bang, bang, bang. And Gary and my uncle tells me, said, hey, damn, brother, your cousin of yours, he's went in there and he screwed up my brand new truck and I'm quitting. Man, Gary, this guy quit. And Gary comes right out the front door and I'm in my little white lowrider getting ready to leave. And he goes, you're fired.
Said, thank you.
I said, cool. I said, I'm late to get to Springfield. I got a race tonight anyway.
That's about it.
And that's how it happened.
Yeah.
I got fired and my career took off.
Rusty found a local tire company to back him and a builder to supply his engines, and soon he was winning ASA races from California to Maine. With little brother Kenny in tow, Rusty racked up more than 200 wins in the series. It was the Wallace racing success that led to Kenny's unlikely nickname, Herman.
Well, it's kind of funny. When Dad, like Rusty said earlier, Dad used to win all the time, and he'd win like 10, 11 features in a row, and it got to where people hated us. And that's the truth. They really did not.
They hated you by association.
Yeah.
And nobody liked the winner.
Yeah.
We won too much.
Yeah.
And that was the deal. And so finally, they just quit. They get booing real hard because we won too much. And
yeah.
So then when we had bad luck, then they'd start cheering again. You know?
Yeah. So what happened was, I think a couple of times my dad won a race or something, and I heard something, and I just wailed a guy right in the face. And they really made me mad. You know, they were talking bad about my dad. And I guess at that time I was 11, 12 years old. So the guy who ran the Central Auto Racing Association, his name was Bob Miller. And he heard all this stuff going on with this, you know, Kenny Wallace, this Russ Wallace's boy. And he just, out of clear blue, he called me Herman the German. And I guess maybe in some cartoon character, Herman the German was like, you know, some ornery little kid. And now it's short for Herman. Everybody calls me.
While Rusty is a bit more reserved, Kenny runs wide open all the time. A trait that brought he and his wife, Kim, together back when they were still in high school.
Kenny is versatile. That's all I can say. When he goes up to speak, I sit there in an audience and I'm like, what is he gonna say next?
Where's them shorts underwear? That's the color Daddy does. See? Checkered flags. Ouch, silly girl.
You know, nothing really embarrasses him as far as, you know, acting silly or whatever, but that's kind of how my kids, I mean, he acts with my kids, dancing around and acting silly with them. You know, but He does. He can make you laugh. He's always on, like I said, on an upbeat.
Brookie.
What did I do?
If you don't give me a kiss, I'm gonna cry.
No.
You don't love me.
Brittany,
kind of kiss.
Brittany.
No. Nobody will give me a kiss. There, my girl. Okay, give me a kiss now, quick.
No,
hurry up. They all want their mama. Does anybody love me?
Wendy does.
Dog.
Well, if nobody loves me, I want my dog. Come here, Wendy. That's why I got a dog. Hands all clean.
While Kenny's schedule is hectic, he enjoys relaxing and spending time with his three daughters, Brooke, Brandy, and Brittany.
Stop it. Here, hold on. Hold on, you're spinning out. Okay.
He's a wonderful husband and a wonderful dad. The girls just idolize him, you know. That's one of the highlights of our day, is waiting for him to come home.
Oh, I love you.
Like Kenny, Rusty also covets the time he can spend with his wife, Patty, and their three children, Greg, Katie, and Stephen.
Contrary to everybody's belief, he's very relaxed and laid back. I know he's hyper at the racetrack, and he's always hopping around talking a mile a minute. But when he's at home, he's usually in the chair with the ottoman and the remote control, watching the Weather Channel, keeping up with all that weather for aviation. But just very laid back and very relaxed, and he's a real good dad. Rusty's best point is that he's never, never down. So he can find the little hole of optimism, and no matter what, how grave the situation may seem, he'll find it, and he'll usually make it better. You never tell him, no, you can't get this done, or no, you can't accomplish it, because he'll just make you look like a total fool, and he'll get it accomplished or get it done. I really admire that in him. I'm more of a laid-back person. I can't do it today. Okay, I'll do it tomorrow. But he's always very driven and always can accomplish things.
Rusty and his family are able to enjoy the benefits of a successful Winston Cup career. But like all big league drivers, Rusty, too, was a rookie once and knows what it's like to pay his dues.
I started running USAC in '80, early '80. And me and A.J. Foyt and all those guys, Ontario, California, Trent, New Jersey, and all that stuff. And then Don Miller, which is my business manager and big buddy of mine and my partner now, he was working for Penske back then, selling apparel and doing some sponsorship work. And he talked to Roger. He said, let's take that Caprice we got out back that we bought that we're not going to do anything with. Let's put a motor in it and fix it up and hire Tex Pyle and some other people. Let's try to run that thing. And Roger says, you guys are all lunatics. I mean, we won't be competitive. I mean, we've been out of the sport too long now. Well, we put that baby together. We went to Atlanta and tested, and then went back for the race and qualified seventh and finished second in the race. And, man, holy smokes, we were off and running then.
All of a sudden, it didn't come together. It took another two or three years.
It didn't come together because it was a first-time deal that happened, and his IndyCar team was really hot, and everything was going good, and we were running that stock car out of that IndyCar shop. And right after that good fortune in Atlanta, we just had all kinds of problems after that. I mean, just the car wouldn't run, and we wrecked it and tore the drive shaft out of it. I did wrong things. I didn't know how to drive one of those cars. I mean, I had a good handling car at Atlanta, and I took it from, I ran good with it, you know. There's a lot of drivers out there that if the car's handling perfect, they can drive it. But if it's not handling, they can't do it. And the key nowadays is understanding the chassis, understanding how to win a race. There's a big difference between racing and understanding how to win.
That's why experience is so important, isn't it?
Yeah. I tell you what, that's one thing about Winston Cup. I mean, it's not how old you are, it's how smart you are. And the older guys tend to run better most of their time because they understand the tracks, they understand the chassis, they've been there, they know what's going on. And this sport's physically demanding, but nothing like, I don't compare it to a stick and ball sport, you know. I mean, when you get in that car and it's 120 degrees in that baby, and you're out there for 5 hours, like you well know at Dover, Delaware, and Rockingham, and the Southern 500, and Talladega, and all that. You know, now we got windows in the doggone things that keeps hotter yet.
Worse.
Yeah, but I mean, it's been a long time coming.
Rusty grasped the concept of understanding how to win, and soon was one of the hottest drivers on the Winston Cup circuit. Teaming up with the Blue Max team in 1986, Rusty won 18 races in four seasons and the coveted championship in 1989. 1989 proved to be a pivotal year for Rusty Wallace. Now, it might be true that people don't like people who win too much. At the Winston that year, Rusty and Darrell Walter got together on the final lap. This incident proved to be a critical moment for both Rusty and Darrell. Now, DW, who had previously been thought of as the bad guy, was now the fans' little darling. And for the first time in his career, Rusty was seen as the bad guy. The fans started booing him, and it's taken Rusty 3 years to overcome the image problem and to win back his supporters. start in racing came preparing cars for Rusty.
Me and Rusty, I guess, come out of the same mold. Money is important to me now, but back then, it didn't matter. I mean, just as long as I was having fun, I was still in school, Benny, and, you know, partially still dumb and, you know, and very blind, you know. So, we just ended up, you know, I just wanted to do everything Rusty wanted to do. I mean, we lived, ate, and slept racing. We were the last two to live at home. Mike got married and went off, and I used to come from school and get to the garage at 4:30 sharp, work, and at midnight we'd jump on his little white pickup and drive home every night. Midnight, I wake up at 6 in the morning, go to school.
I'll never forget it.
Midnight,
1, 2 o'clock in the morning, the same road up Highway 270 in St. Louis. We'd be leaving that shop. Just so greasy, you couldn't see it. Top to bottom, stunk. God, terrible.
It was bad.
I mean, real grease monkeys.
You got off the school bus at the race car shop.
Yeah, well, see, my senior year, my 11th and 12th grade, I was able to drive my car because I was in high school. So I would jump right out of school, you know, 7th hour, jump right in my car, buddy. And that was it. Listen to this, and I'm not proud of this, but I missed 72 days of school, 10th, 11th, and 12th grade, and I had to go in front of two boards, and what they said was, they said, if you miss an excessive amount of days, so many days, you have to go in front of this board. Counselors, you know, the president of the school, all these people, tell them why. And if you did not give them a good reason that this council felt, you know, they would flunk you. And I told him, you know, I said, I'm going to race. Racing's going to be what I'm going to do. And I'm out racing with my brother, you know. And Rusty got some good write-ups in the major newspapers, and so they passed me both times.
Kenny made his racing debut at the Street Stock State Championship in Springfield, Illinois. Driving Pat Walsh's car, Kenny surprised a lot of people when, just like Brother Rusty, he won his first race. Kenny started driving full-time when Rusty's old car owner, John Chow, decided to go racing again. Kenny won ASA Rookie of the Year and had success on the circuit. But his big break came when Rusty won the championship and decided to start his own team.
I won the championship in 89, had some money to build a shop, so I took the money that I was going to have to pay to IRS and spent some money on building a shop, did that. And then in the meantime, I drove the Cox Treated Lumber car for a fellow by the name of Don Miller up in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, which you probably know. And I got to know the Cox people real well. Well, they wanted to run some more races, and I couldn't run any more races. And so then I told them about Kenny coming down and tried to get Kenny in a Cox car. That wouldn't work out. So then they asked me, so you ever thought about being a car owner? I said, me a car owner? No, I haven't. So we had a sponsor before I built the shop. So we got the sponsorship put together, built the shop. I called Kenny. He loaded everything up in the back of his pickup truck, came on down, and we did a couple of personal services agreements with Oakwood Homes, and they gave us a mobile home, and we set the mobile home, and Kenny and Kim and the kids lived in that until they got established.
And Kenny Wallace will do it. He will win his first Busch Grand National race here at the Volusia County Speedway. Your Spring 200 winner, Tommy Houston, comes home second.
Kenny met with even more success in the Busch Series, again capturing Rookie of the Year. Kenny won three races in 3 years before Rusty sold the outfit to Felix Sabatas, who has turned it into a Winston Cup team. It was Felix who gave Kenny a chance to get his feet wet in Winston Cup back in 1991, driving for the injured Kyle Petty. Now the stakes are higher, the competition stiffer, and the speeds faster. The one constant, Kenny's upbeat outlook.
We're going to go from one end of the spectrum to the right hand of the grandstands all the way to the left. Got to get all these fans happy. We're going to give away them hand vacs.
Kenny's the same guy. He will never change. He will never change. Kenny is probably the most likable person, not just because he's my husband, but he's probably the most likable person out there. He's friendly, to everybody, and he's always the same way.
I guess we're the first race car driver team to ever do this, huh?
Yeah.
Kind of wild. Hey. Oh, man. We're going to have to give out more. There's too many people. Okay. Well, here, this one for you. There you go. Congratulations, man. You get a hand back. She'll take care of you, okay? Running with the devil. There you go. Let me sign that for you real quick.
All right.
Who we got here? Who's in charge of this sign? You did good, man. I'll give you the one right off my head. Thanks, darling. There you go.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. Okay, want me to sign a hat for you?
Yes, please.
Okay.
Kenny is rapidly gaining fan support and respect from other drivers on the track. And while he isn't finishing where he'd like to, he's patiently going through the learning process and paying his dues.
Good afternoon, Penske Racing.
In 1991, Rusty Wallace and Don Miller struck out with Roger Penske to form a new Winston Cup team. While they won a respectable two races in each of the first 2 years, for some of Rusty's fans, that wasn't enough.
88, I won six races. 89, I won six races. And there is a gillion people out there that haven't won one yet, okay? And so I go the next year. Jesus, I only sat on three pole. Jesus, I only won two races. And they go, what is wrong with Rusty? He only won two races this year. And I'm going, let's back up and think about that for a minute, you know?
Rusty, crew chief Buddy Parrott, and the rest of the Miller Genuine Draft crew have devoted themselves and the 93 season to only one goal, winning the championship. Rusty dominated the first eight races of the 93 season, starting with a win at Rockingham. Winning Bristol from the pole, followed by wins at North Wilkesboro and Martinsville, Rusty owned the month of April. Had it not been for a wreck with 28 laps to go at Daytona, where he was running second, Rusty would have finished in the top five in each of his first eight starts. Rusty knows these results are the first fruit of the team's decision to win.
I never realized a new team was going to be this tough to get going. I've had a lot of great guys. Then I had three or four bad apples that were just enough to really stir up a big mess in the shop. And once I realized who those guys were, and they end up going, and we replaced it with some better guys that were real thoroughbred racers that want to win, then everything started going better. And Don started to understand how to run the race team better, and I started to understand how to cope with people and what to do and what not to do. Because I never had to do that in the Blue Max team. Dotson did all that, Barry did. And, boy, he had a job that I didn't realize. And that got better, but then we still weren't there. And then when we hired Buddy, then the team finally turned all, instead of everybody having their own opinions how to do things, then they started putting all the respect in Buddy. Buddy demanded respect from him, and they gave him the respect. They knew what to do. The cars were prepared on time. Everything was going good. Then the second half of 92, man, we took off. And then the end of the 92 season, we made a commitment. We made a decision to win. It was a lot different than trying to win. The decision to win means more time at the racetrack, less time with their families, more time testing, more time concentrating on race cars and just race cars only. Yeah, I can go on and on about what the decision to win compared to I want to win does to you. We did that. We changed engine programs. We let Mike Kennedy in High Point, North Carolina, build all our Talladega and Daytona engines, so that would leave my fellow David Evans free to do nothing but these type of engines for Charlotte, Michigan, short tracks. Then we got an extensive workout program. The guys over pit road are fast as lightning now. The car's better with the new nose and the tail. Well, those three things right there, and then the fourth thing, me getting on a big exercise program and really saying, hey, this is it.
observing Rusty's racing success, Kenny has set a course to follow his brother's lead.
Rusty's wired for sound, and I'll be honest, I'd be a lot hyper than I was right now if people always wouldn't, you know, my gosh, you're too much like your brother. You better calm down. You better calm down. And I'm like, well, I think, you know, Rusty's winning. You know, I mean, it's like Darrell Walter told me one time. He says, this racing's a monkey see, monkey do business. If somebody puts on four, you better put on four. If everybody's running Goodyears, you better run Goodyears. Well, I hate to say it, but if my brother does flips down pit road and wins six races, well, I'm going to do me some flips, too. You know what I mean?
No.
I didn't go that far, did
I? No. What about that? I mean, just what was, I mean, when you left Daytona, you had to be as far down as you've been in the last two or three years because you really had a good race car.
I went in, I was way down because I went in that race going, okay, this is a year, this is my year. The new engine program, the pit stops, man, the car, everything, you know. And we ran good the whole week of Daytona. Third in the class right off the bat, that first segment. Then the 125, we had a fuel pickup problem. But then we went good from 34th to 2nd, the Daytona 500. And just sitting there trucking along with 28 laps to go, it happens. But the big decision, the thing that didn't kill us, is that we made that decision to win when we went in it. We made that decision, we're going for that championship.
I was about 10 car lengths behind him coming off of turn two, and he started flipping, and I seen exactly what happened, and, you know, just kept being a racer and went on, but was pretty well sick to my stomach, and I guess when I come around the corner and the car was sitting there, you know, I was just, you know, just really concerned, got on the radio, asked my guys, you know, how he is and everything, and they calmed me down, I guess, you know, I don't know, I guess my voice gets a little high-pitched when I get excited, and, you know, just it concerned me, you know, a whole bunch, you know. I mean, it's one thing being what they call a Bavarian, you know, just doing your job, but, you know, we all are people, and, you know, he could have been dead. I mean, Rusty could have got killed in that crash, and, you know, I got a job to do, but the crew told me he was okay, and that's the first thing that went through my mind. Is he okay, or is he dead, or what?
You're in the race, and you look ahead of you, or you look in your mirror, and you see the black 40. I mean, it's just more than another car, is it, Rusty?
Yeah, it really is, because when he's having a good day, I'm really super happy, and when he's having a bad day, I'm really feeling for him, you know? When I see him up there in the top lane, and he's sliding around on top of the racetrack, and we're flying around in the bottom, pass him or something, I'm going, man, I wish he could get that car handling better. I wish he could get that thing going, because I know it's tearing at him, because I know he can drive the car. I watched him time after time. I mean, just two straight to the front when you get it right, you know. He's real aggressive, real super aggressive, real good driver. And I'm not hands-on his team like I was in the Grand National team. And with the Grand National team, it wasn't much of a problem. I mean, he won a lot of races with it. We stuck it right at the front of the lead. But it's kind of like this. I mean, he's helped me so much, and I wanted to try to return the favor. And we're so tight as brothers, it's unreal. We talk about it every day on the phone. And I told him, I said, I got you this far. I got you. You're a little bird now, and now you're flying, you know? And I just turned you loose, and now you're flying off to this new Winston Cup thing. And when things don't go right, it makes me mad, and it hurts me, you know, and I see him not handling, and I got to stay back.
You got your own thing that you have to take care of.
Yeah, I got my own thing. You know, I mean, I know it works. I mean, I've been doing this stuff forever.
And your thing's doing pretty well right now.
My stuff's doing all right, you know? And so when I try to help, I try to help, but there's only so much I can do, you know.
While he realizes there are some things Kenny must learn on his own, Rusty knows the best way to teach is by example, and Rusty is showing the way by his dedication to win and his involvement at his shop.
Yeah, I'm there every day that I can be there. That's my office. I go to work every morning. I get up and I get in my car and I drive to work every day. I do all my autographs, my fan mail. I go back and look at the cars, me and Buddy Parrott and Todd and Terry Satchel and David Evans. We talk about what we're going to do the next race. We talk about carburation. We talk about headers. We talk about, I give David all the feedback that I can. I'm no motor man, but I know what they feel like. I know if I like it, if I don't like it. Give him that feedback. We make a decision. We sit in Buddy's office. We feel out chassis and setups for the next race, what we're going to go there at. We look at our past records and looked at how the car was and think how to improve it. Yeah, I'm there all the time.
Being a rookie, and because he wants to win, Kenny is eager to learn and pays close attention to the information Rusty teaches.
Benny, you know, as this interview goes on right now, we're just starting out totally. Rusty helps me out a lot and gives me all his setups to the T. I take, hand them over to my crew chief, and it's up to him right now at this point to install them if he wants. See, I'm in a situation right now. You gotta walk lightly when you're a rookie. You can't burn no bridges, because if you offer too much suggestions and then things also don't turn out good, well, then it gets to where, you know, this rookie needs to calm down. He's too hyperactive, you know. He's this and he's that. So it's just like what Rusty went back to the first interview. Man, I want to be in there. I want to go in the garage every day when they're setting a chassis up. I want to say, what springs we got in this? What do we got here? What do we got there? But, you know, you got to be careful, because the first answer you get is, hey, look, we're putting the setups in. Here's what we got. Now you just get the racetrack and drive it.
Not only is the pressure on to perform against more experienced drivers, there's also the pressure of working for Rookie of the Year. And with the most talented rookie class in over a decade, the three-way battle for the title will provide serious competition for Kenny.
You know, Benny, somebody, I believe it was you, asked me that Daytona at a radio show, you know, do you wish you would have picked another year? First of all, I'm thoroughly glad that this is the year I picked, because, you know, you can win Rookie of the Years and you can lose Rookie of the Years, but, you know, if you're running for Rookie of the Year by yourself, you just automatically get Rookie of the Year. I have won every Rookie of the Year I've ever entered, ASA, the Busch Grand National Series. Right now, I'm thrilled to death to be in this race. Whether I win it or I lose it, it absolutely does not make one bit of difference to me. Now, there are people that want it to make a big difference to me, because they can't conceive that it really doesn't bother me. I have people every day that, oh, Jeff Gordon this, oh, Bobby Labonte this. And if I don't give them the correct answer, the correct way they want me to answer them, then they feel like it's bothering me. But the honest to God's truth is I want to do what I got to do this year, the year that's going to make me or break me. What the year is going to make me or break me is down the road. I want to be able to have a house, you know, and take care of my kids and stuff. And winning Rookie of the Year is going to help me out, and I'm going to strive to do that. But it's not a do-or-die situation.
With Rusty already established as a series champ, Kenny looking to gain a foothold in Winston Cup, and Mike seeking an opportunity to move to the big leagues, the old adage of blood is thicker than water might